Today, we're taking a look at the FlashForge AD5X, a compact, budget-friendly, multicolor 3D printer that promises a lot at a lower price point. But is it actually worth it, or are you better off spending more on something like a Bambu or a Prusa setup? Now, I've been testing this thing with a bunch of prints, including some multicolor, and I want to break down this review into four things: affordability, features, print quality, and repairability. One of its big selling points of the AD5X is its price. Compared to a Bambu Lab Core XY multi-material setup, this comes in a lot cheaper. And the whole multicolor system is really compact when you think about it. It doesn't take up very much space when sitting on a table or on a shelf or wherever you decide to put it. Now, here are a couple downsides. If you do want a camera, you do have to pick that up for an additional $40. And they do also offer an enclosure kit for about $49, which realistically isn't too bad given the fact that you can always expand into that later. But I would have liked to seen the camera as just a standard feature on the printer, but I do understand that they're trying to hit that certain price point. So going a little bit lower price and making you pick that up later, I kind of get that. A quick discussion before we go any further. This printer was sent to me by FlashForge for review. Now, this video is not sponsored by FlashForge and they had no input on this video. But this video is sponsored by my Patreon, which you can find a link down in the description below. I just launched it, so go check it out if you want to help support the channel and for me to be able to do more cool stuff like this and upcoming projects, which you're definitely going to want to get subscribed for. Real quick, let's talk about the features of this printer and where the 85X has some good ideas, but a few little bit frustrations. One thing that I really like about this printer is its small footprint. Considering the fact that it has four spools sticking off the side of it and it's a multicolor, multi-material system, it's actually really small compared to, say, something like a Bambu Lab A1, where you have a whole separate module that sits on the side. Now, the trade-off is going to be a smaller build plate than, say, something like the Bambu Lab A1 or the P1P or any of those series of printers. Now, you're not going to be doing gigantic prints on this, but for everyday projects, it's plenty. I've had no issues with this so far. If I recall correctly, this is about the max height of what this printer can do. Something that is absolutely cool about the way that they handle the multicolor system on here, they have these really cool retention system right here, which is very similar to kind of what's on the AMS Lite from Bambu Lab, where you can just slide on your spools like so, and they hold on pretty nicely. So far, I found that the Elegoo, the Bambu Lab, obviously the FlashForge stuff sits on here pretty quickly, easily. Any cubic stuff fits on here nicely. The one thing that I found that does not fit on here very nicely is the Sunlu filament rolls. You do need to have the adapter in order to put those on here. And the way that this handles the whole multicolor, multi-material system is this little box right here. Basically what this is it's just motors inside here that are feeding in the filament from each slot. What's interesting is that you have PTFE tubes that you slide them into on each one here. Hopefully these are replaceable because I actually messed one of mine up already. Now, moving on to the connectivity for this thing, it does have Wi-Fi or Ethernet. There is an Ethernet port in the back of this thing, which is a really nice thing to see. I will say that when I was setting up the Wi-Fi for this printer, it was painfully slow. But once you get it up and running, it does seem to be working just fine remotely through their cloud system. The fact that it has Ethernet on the back, I really do love to see that. Maybe one day I'll actually get a whole network set up back here in the studio area of my garage where I could plug everything in and not have everything rely on Wi-Fi. Maybe one day. Now, on the software side, you are going to be using FlashForge's skinned version of Orca Slicer. It's functional, but there are some things I wish that would be fixed. One thing I really don't like is that if I want to do a multicolor print, I have to manually put in the colors on each, you know, filament that you select there. It doesn't sync over automatically. I could be wrong with that. So if I am, let me know down in the comments below, but I'm pretty sure it doesn't sync. I don't see the button for it like I do on the Bambu Lab slicer. Now, I think that's really a big weak point of this printer, especially when it comes to the multicolor workflow, as this is obviously very heavily marketed as a multicolor printer. On the topic of some things that I don't like, the mobile app. Every time you open it, you get an ad. I really hate that. Now, it's an ad for FlashForge, so I kind of get it, but at the same time, I'm opening the app because I need to check on the printer. I want to send something to the printer. I don't want to see an ad for FlashForge. Now, something that is absolutely cool is that the tool head cover on the printer is both magnetic and wireless. So you don't have to worry about unplugging the fan every time you take this off. It's got some little connectors here on the back that connect with a board on the tool head. And it's just super easy to install and uninstall. It's just put it on, push it down, and it snaps right in, and you're good to go. I really like that. I want to see that on more printers, especially like the Bambu Labs, which you have to unplug that wire every time, and I always feel like I'm gonna break it. Now, it hasn't been smooth sailing this entire time. The screen is quite sluggish, and you do have to manually hit clear on every print to reset the job to be able to print again. If you ever need to get broken filament out of these PTFE tubes, good luck. They are tough to remove, and that makes clearing the jams a real pain in the... I had some older Sunlu filament that's been sitting out, and it got quite brittle, and they broke in multiple of these tubes, which was a nightmare to get out because I couldn't get it from here. I had to attack it from here. I couldn't get these stupid things to let go of the PTFE tube so I could pull it out. The Bambu Lab A1 and A1 Mini use something similar, and I hate these things. I would like to see us move away from these into something that's a much better solution. What that solution is, I don't know. Maybe you could tell me down in the comments below. Okay, now probably one of the most important parts. How does it print? What's the print quality like? Out of the box, the results are pretty solid. Now, I ran a bunch of fun models through this thing. One of the first things that I printed was this Duck of Darkness, rest in peace, Ozzy Osbourne. This thing turned out so cool. Whoever came up with this, I really love this. This is gonna be sitting out in for everyone to look at. And I printed this in Prusa Mint PLA Vanilla, if I recall correctly. And it printed out great. The details are phenomenal. You can see a little bit of some layer lines, but nothing too bad. Some of the overhangs could do a little bit better. Actually, this was supports, my mistake, not overhang. But under here, this didn't print perfectly. Now, I'm not sure if this was an issue with the cooling or if this was just maybe too much of a slope for the printer to handle. It doesn't seem too bad. I think it could have done a little bit better, but overall, this thing printed out really cool. And on to the next one. Next up, I printed out this Boba Fett statue here. This thing turned out great. I really should start writing down what I print these in. I want to say I printed this in Elegoo's Rapid PETG Red, and it turned out quite nicely. The filament definitely needed to be dried because you can see that there are quite a bit of little zits on here. So I'm gonna put this up to the filament needing to be dried and not an issue with the printer itself. There is a little bit of stringing on the back to help kind of reinforce that. There was supports on this and they released fairly easy, but overall it printed great. Next up, my son asked me for this, so I thought it would be a good opportunity to test the printer out. And this is a Lemmings. Now, if you have kids, you've probably seen this little creature here before. I didn't fully print out everything. He's missing part of his eyes and his feet, and he looks super cute. Printed quite nicely. This is in Elegoo's PLA Pro Gray, if I recall correctly. Next up, I really wanted to test out the multicolor capabilities of this printer. And I learned the hard way that you can't just set a Sunlu filament on here without an adapter because this will happen. Unfortunately, this did not finish printing because the red got tangled and it wouldn't pull through the extruder anymore. So it just messed up. I did fix it by putting a adapter on the filament spool so it would fit on here properly. And I printed out this Iron Man piggy bank, which turned out really cool. Now, it did waste a lot of filament, just like every other printer on the market. That's not a dual nozzle or multi-head kind of printer. This still does have to purge out between color changes. Same thing here, the overhangs didn't do super well, but I'm not sure if that's an issue with the printer or just the file, but it's a super cool print and it will make a very nice little piggy bank. Now, if you are going to be doing the multicolor stuff, it does make sense to run more than one of them on a build plate at a time. I printed out these little witch dragons, and these things are super cute. This one still has the supports on here, so we'll go ahead and get it off. Supports are coming off decently easy. I think the issue I'm struggling with is that they're so small, I'm having a hard time getting them off, getting my fingers in there to kind of peel them off. Settings for this could have been a little bit better on the support side. It printed out really nicely. There's not a ton of color bleed as near as I can tell. It does look quite good. It is awfully cute. I ended up printing six of these to help reduce the waste, but even then, there is still a big bucket of filament purge here. Now, the last couple of things that I have here to show is the rocket engine from Prusa. This is a great test file, I feel like. It really shows the capabilities of these printers. And honestly, this printed out great. I maximized the height on this as high as it would go to see how big the print would be. And overall, it's a good size, I feel like. It's not super small, but it's not huge either. There is a little bit of stringing in here. The filament probably could have used a dry. I really feel like this is a great print to test printers with, just because there's so many intricate details and overhang tests and stuff like that. On the inside, it looks great. There's no issues with this thing. And the last one I have here to show in the spirit of Halloween is a skull candy bowl. This thing printed out so cool. I really like this. I'm gonna be using this for the whole month to stick some candy in here. This printed without supports, which is really impressive. I think this thing is so cool. Inside printed nicely, there's no issues. Bottom is quite good. I did use a brim for whatever reason. It kind of auto defaulted to it and I forgot to turn it off. There is a good test down here. It shows that it printed nicely. Overall, everything printed out quite nicely, especially at this price point. When FlashForge said that they were gonna be sending this out to me, I ended up watching ModBot's breakdown of this printer to kind of see what his thoughts were going to be. And he mentioned that there is quite a bit of noise coming from the Z-hop behavior. And yes, it is very loud. Now, as you could hear in that clip, every time it moves up and around, it's so loud for some reason. Now, overall, the printer is relatively quiet with the exception of that. Now, finally, repairability. Parts availability is something that is really important in the 3D printing space. Nothing sucks more than having a printer break down on you and you can't get replacement parts. Now, there are printers like the Elegoo Centauri Carbon, the AnyCubic could do a little bit better as well, where the parts aren't readily available on the website to purchase. I think the best people out there for that is going to be Prusa and Bambu Lab. FlashForge does a decent job, actually. They have quite a bit of replacement parts on the website to keep your printer running, which is a big plus. But that could definitely do better. I'm a huge advocate for right to repair, especially in this space, because tinkering and modding is so prevalent. That said, I do wish it was a little bit easier to work on this printer. I did find this whole mess up here of the PTFE tubes to be just really annoying. I ended up breaking part of the plastic to fix that, but it is what it is, and I got it up and running again. So now the big question, is this printer worth it? Honestly, if you're looking for an affordable printer that does multicolor printing in a small compact system, it's hard to beat this. But if you're okay with the trade-offs, the smaller build plate, the slow screen, the noise and the clunky software, and the little annoyances like having to hit clear after every print, if you're okay with those, you're probably gonna be happy with it. Now, if you are doing the multicolor printing and you're gonna have a ton of filament, you should definitely check out this video right here where I'm printing the ultimate solution for that. And this is part one. I'll see you over there.